Well, good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure for me to welcome you to this session on access to medicines, a solutions-based approach. We'll be here for the next 90 minutes, and we have what I think will be a very lively discussion planned for you. My name is Jeff Sturcio. I'm the CEO of Raben Martin, a global health consulting firm, and I'm also a member of the Expert Advisory Council of the Noncommunicable Diseases Alliance. What we're here to talk about are some real-world approaches to cancer care and control in lower and middle-income countries. I don't need to tell this audience about the challenges that the global community faces in providing improvements in cancer care and control in that part of the world. By 2030, we expect that 7 out of 10 cancer cases will be in developing countries. And in 2012, 3/4 of global cancer deaths were in lower and middle income countries. So it's clear that this is a major challenge for the global community. More importantly, there's a tremendous imbalance in the way in which cancer is treated in lower and middle income countries relative to the burden of illness. Only there are estimates from the Global Task Force on Cancer Care and Control in Developing Countries that only 5% of the global resources devoted to cancer care and control go to those countries, but those countries are responsible for 80% of the disability-adjusted life years lost from cancer. So that imbalance of 580, as it's called, is really a challenge for the community of everybody concerned about cancer and its treatment and care. Now, why is there such an imbalance? You know, there are many reasons, and we'll talk about some of them this morning, but partly it's the result of a set of myths about cancer. You know, cancer has been known for decades as the dread disease or diseases, and there's a lot of stigma around it. That's one of the reasons why people shy away from dealing effectively with cancer. But the myths are, there are a group of pernicious myths that have cropped up around cancer that it's impractical to try to treat it in lower and middle income countries for a variety of reasons. There isn't the infrastructure, there aren't the resources, and so people are just left to their own devices. You know, others claim that you can't treat cancer in lower and middle income countries because the treatments are ineffective. Well, you know, I'm sure many of you have a different point of view about that, but that's also one of the myths. Another is that the health system has inadequate resources to treat cancer in lower and middle income countries, particularly when they're faced with a dual burden of disease and still a large burden of infectious disease. And finally, probably the most pernicious myth is that it's inappropriate to try to treat cancer in lower and middle income countries because there are so many other problems that the health system has to deal with. And because of the other myths, we know we can't do anything serious about cancer, so let's not waste resources on it. Well, I think that those really are myths. And if you think about the experience in the global community with HIV and AIDS and TB in recent decades, it shows just how much can be accomplished if you explode those myths and look at the practical problems of providing the right interventions in the right way for people who are living with cancer. And we're seeing this already in cancer, that with using the existing infrastructure more creatively and effectively with task shifting, it really is possible to ensure that the right interventions get to more people. We've seen expansion of available treatments in many cases. We've seen innovative financing solutions and innovative approaches to prevention, early diagnosis, and treatment that are really making a difference for millions of people in lower and middle income countries. And that's really the focus of today's discussion. Through effective partnerships, we're seeing that the prospects for treating more people with cancer and doing it effectively and sustainably are really improving dramatically. And our speakers this morning will show us just what is possible through the implementation of effective policies and through novel partnerships among government, the medical community, medical institutions, civil society organizations, and communities. So our speakers are going to offer you some practical perspectives on these issues and a view of just how much can be done for cancer in lower and middle income countries. Now I'm going to shift to the table and join my colleagues here. Let me just introduce our speakers first, and then we'll get started. The way we're going to structure this session is to have a series of initial interventions from each of the speakers. We'll have a dialogue among us then for 30 minutes or so, and then we'll open the floor to comments and questions from all of you. So you'll have a good period of time to engage in this discussion as well. From all the way at the far left, let me start there. Dr. Salsan Almadi is the Director General for Friends of Cancer Patients in the United Arab Emirates. She has significant experience in working in the nonprofit and charitable sector and has been doing a terrific job as the Director General of the Friends of Cancer Patients in the UAE. She's trained in internal medicine. She's a fellow of the Royal Society of Medicine and a member of the Royal College of Physicians in the UK. She's had experience working clinically at the Dubai Health Authority as well as the Ministry of Health in Sharjah, and also has a master's degree in health management from the Royal College of Surgeons of Ireland. She's an active member of a number of organizations working on cancer care and control in the Gulf and elsewhere, and has really been a leader in the community of patient advocates for those living with cancer. So we're really pleased that Salsan can be here. To her right, we have, let's see here, let me make sure. One second. There we are. Yeah, oh, thanks. to her right is Dr. Joseph Cabaccio, who's the head of the Division of NCDs at the Ministry of Health in Kenya, where he's responsible for public health policy on NCDs and their determinants throughout the country. He's a doctor who has significant public health expertise and specializes in NCD epidemiology, programming, and policy issues in resource-limited settings. He's also involved not just in Kenya, but on the global level. He's a member of the WHO Global Coordination Mechanism Expert Working Group on the inclusion of NCDs into public health programs. And then within Kenya, he convenes the Intersectoral Coordinating Committee for NCDs and has an important role in public health governance and mentorship throughout the country. He's also a lecturer in public health at the Kenyatta and Moi Universities Schools of Public Health and is a fellow of the Royal Society of Public Health. Next to Joseph is Dr. Viji Venkatesh. She's the regional head for India and South Asia of the Max Foundation. She began her work in cancer patient care and support more than three decades ago, so she has tremendous experience in working with other patient advocates in the patient community on these issues. You'll hear more about her work at the Max Foundation during her presentation. And she's done a lot to expand the work of the Max Foundation to include patients and their caregivers and families in the work they're doing. For instance, the Max Foundation has a network of patient support groups across India that involves more than 18,000 people. She's had many leadership roles in the cancer care arena. She had been the Asia coordinator of the Union for International Cancer Control before going to the Max Foundation. And she also set up the preventive oncology department at Tata Memorial Hospital in the 1990s. She's won awards for her work, including the Scroll of Honor for her outstanding contribution in the field of social service from the Health Minister of Bihar at the World Cancer Day celebrations in Patna, India. And then to my left is Dr. Alfred Karagu. Dr. Karagu is the Chief Executive Officer of the National Cancer Institute of Kenya. And he's also the cancer control focal point for the Division of NCDs at the Kenya Ministry of Health. He has significant experience in clinical care and health services management, in monitoring and evaluation, and training in public health research, and really is, as you'll hear, is a strong believer in innovation in health systems management and fostering partnerships to improve the delivery of healthcare services for cancer patients. His background is in general management and public health. He has degrees in medicine and surgery and a master's of science in health systems management and has also been trained in field epidemiology and laboratory sciences. So as you can see, we have a very distinguished panel who have a wide variety of experience in this area. And I think that You'll see through their interventions a range of interesting perspectives on the challenge in front of us this morning on how to improve access to medicines for people in lower and middle income countries. So why don't we start by just, let's start with the most general question, and if I could turn to Dr. Cabaccio, and just let's start by thinking about how you set the stage for the national health system in addressing cancer among all the other priorities that a health system has. What do you need to do to get the right policies in place and to find the right partnerships to help improve cancer care and control in Kenya?
Thanks, Jeff. It's quite interesting to be here in this panel, and thanks for attending this side event. Let me just start by saying to us as a Kenyan Ministry of Health, and also in the sub-Sahara countries, NCDs have hitherto been, you know, neglected owing to other competing interests. That is actually a fact. But going forth, we just realized that the burden of NCDs is actually bigger than the burden of infectious diseases if you are to put all factors together. And so our focus is shifting, not that we are ignoring the infectious diseases, but we are now appreciating the dual burden of disease. Now, if I may just narrow down to cancer infrastructure, the cancer infrastructure currently in our country is, you know, not what we would expect. There's a lot of inequalities, of course, within countries and between countries in sub-Sahara Africa. And if I may just narrow down towards our country, again, within the country, there's a lot of inequalities with some people having better access and others having virtually no access to cancer treatment and the whole spectrum of prevention, treatment, and even palliative care. Now, with that in mind, then as a government, we sit back as policymakers and wonder, how do we move forth? Let me just start by saying that my belief, and I think it's the belief of the entire ministry, is that the cancer infrastructure of a country, I equate it to the military. I'm yet to see a military that is established through donor aid by another country. I mean, it's a thing that should be owned by a ministry. It's a thing that the government should own. And then aid, of course, fills in the gaps. And that is our thinking going forth. So the government is investing a lot in terms of establishing the cancer infrastructure from prevention to treatment to palliative care, the whole spectrum. And I'm happy that even in the panel is Dr. Alfred, who is coordinating the National Cancer Institute. The only problem that we have, and you've mentioned a lot of myths, Jeff, which have crippled our attention towards cancer, these competing interests are usually, they make sense at the political level. But when you come down to the community, when you come down to the individuals, some of those don't make sense. I can give an example of a mother who lost her child to some leukemia. And she's like, when my child is dying, I don't even care about the political rhetoric that we say out there. All I care is that my child should have had treatment. So when such things come to our attention as policymakers, it grieves us. And so moving forth, we're trying to establish partnerships because we can't pretend as a government that we can be able to solve this problem. It's big enough, and we just must start with partnerships. And some of the partnerships that we have had, I'm sure we'll have an opportunity to talk about them later, include, for example, the partnerships which my friends here also are doing in their countries. For example, the Access Program, which avails quality medicine that might be very expensive at competitive or even at no cost, let me not call it free, at no cost to the patient who otherwise would have, you know, had a very rough time. There's also a move within our countries to try and see this duo burden of disease. How can we use the successes that we've had in HIV for NCD purposes? How can we integrate NCDs or HIV or cancers into the HIV platform? 50-60% of the HIV patients anyway have an NCD, and much of it probably is a cancer. So how do we get the resources that are redundant? Because the resources we have for HIV, TB, and malaria, we probably use 60-70% of it. There's a redundant aspect of it that if we layered NCD on top, we will not be jeopardizing the primary HIV structure or malaria or TB. And so moving forth, we are trying to see how do we integrate the two. And of course, finally, there is a move towards universal coverage that for us, we are using the social insurance as our vehicle. And so the coverage of the National Hospital Insurance Fund has been spreading towards covering even NCDs and more so cancers, which are catastrophic in nature. The biggest problem is, of course, families spend so much of their money towards treatment of cancer. And once they're through, this family is left, you know, in poverty. And I think that's something that concerns government.
Well, thanks very much, and that that gets us off to a good start. You know, I think the points you made about integration are important, and we should come back to that because it's a question of, you know, just to put it in simple terms, trying to do more with less. That is, you know, getting as much health as you can out of the money you're investing and using the platforms that are there to address cancer as well as other conditions in primary care. And I think also your point about extending coverage at the end. Is, you know, that's an important policy imperative, especially as countries are starting to think about universal health coverage over the next 15 years to try and reach everybody for a basic package of care, which obviously will include cancer as well. So I think those two points we'll also be coming back to. I wonder if we might, let's just alternate perspectives here. I'll come to Alfred in a bit to ask about the role from the point of view of the National Cancer Institute. But Viji, maybe we could turn to you next and just ask you, you know, having heard from Joseph about the way that the ministry looks at this on a national level to try and integrate all the different perspectives and resources that that the country has to improve cancer care and control, how does that look from the community perspective and the work you're doing at the Max Foundation?
I tend to agree a lot. You know, you're here as a spokesperson of the ministry, and it's the same, I guess, in any government. And in India, I always say that India is like a Europe put together. You know, all the different states, and I mean, it's like, you know, there's so much diversity in language and food and culture and even the way we wear our clothes, and still it's a miracle that we still hold together as a country. But when it comes to policy from the government, each state has its own different policies, especially when it comes to health. And what you said resonates so much that for us, you know, the nonprofit, we are concerned with what it means to a patient. And so when you said about the mother, for her, when her child is diagnosed with a life-threatening illness, she's not bothered about anything except where and how can I get treatment so that my child can live. At the Max Foundation, we what we do is we work in those countries where there is no access to reimbursement, there is no any kind of recourse to insurance, and patients have to spend out of their pockets for their treatment. And we do believe that this is really the most important thing that anyone who works for when a family has to face the diagnosis of cancer, I don't think nobody can even begin to understand what it involves. All that the family wants is treatment. You know, besides stigma, fear, why me, the sense of isolation, it's where we find treatment. And that's how I guess it just seemed to be the most natural thing that we espouse the cause of access to treatment. And today, it's been exactly a decade and a half that we are working on access programs all over, not just Asia, but the Latin America and as well as Africa. And the project that we are involved in, have been involved in all these years, is the drug that changed cancer treatment forever and ever. And the program through which that drug is made available to thousands and thousands and thousands of patients is also a program that changed the meaning of access and brought it's like a revolution, actually. And it's kind of the direct to patient, and I do believe that as much as even the Indian government and the other governments in the region, we know that Pakistan looks after a lot of their patients by donating the drug. We have a lot of good programs in Malaysia and the Philippines and in Latin America especially, but in India, the government is still struggling with infant mortality and polio and cholera and typhoid, waterborne diseases, and now they have started looking at cancer. again, when you look at a program that is run by the government, which is burdened with the sheer numbers, the magnitude of the population it has to cater to, and the bureaucracy, the efficiencies, availability of the drugs, and I find that when we come into the picture with a program, with partnered with the industry, with such a lot of efficiencies at our disposal, which the government machinery does not have, we see that we are making such a big difference to these families. Today, 18,000 families in India last week celebrated Diwali. You know, I don't know how many of them would have celebrated Diwali if it had not been access to the drug that one member of their family needed. So, I mean, I think that's, I can't say anything more than that, actually.
Good. Well, that's it's a good start to understanding how this work looks from the community level. And, you know, and I think you remind us of just, you know, what all of us are working for is to help individuals and their families who are living with cancer to really ensure that that people survive as long as possible and that families can really enjoy everything that life has to bring. So that just is a powerful reminder of why this work is so important. Now, much of this treatment takes place in many countries in institutions like the one that Alfred's responsible for, the National Cancer Institute in Kenya. So let's, again, in this way of alternating back and forth different perspectives, how does it look to you, you know, in terms of how you organize the work that that the Institute does? And it's really, in a sense, an intermediate level between national policy and the community, how you really coordinate the medical and clinical resources that are required to provide care and treatment to patients. So over to you.
Thank you very much. I think from the outset, I would want to take note of you know, the thinking behind our National Cancer Institute. Whereas I know that you know, treatment is a major, you know, mandate or a major, you know, obligation of any National Cancer Institute, I think in our country, there has been a deliberate attempt to sort of broaden the mandate of you know, the Cancer Institute to include, you know, other you know, if you may, extraneous you know, factors that, you know, contribute to cancer treatment. So you find that you know, our mandate includes issues like you know, access to treatment, you know, basically trying to figure out how do we, you know, enhance access to treatment, issues about awareness creation, issues about, you know, you know, strengthening the system to actually, you know, in terms of early detection, diagnosis that will then feed into the actual treatment. So really, for me, from where I come from, you know, the whole issue of partnership is really at the core of what you do. You know, I look at, you know, the governance structure of our institute. We actually have a board of trustees that really, you know, has a very multi-sectoral, you know, representation, looking at probably the key stakeholders who have a role to play in terms of, you know, in terms of making sure that, you know, the clients are able to access the treatment. So really, from the outset, I think we really see partnerships as, you know, as very key to, you know, to contributing to a successful, you know, patient journey from, you know, from diagnosis all the way to treatment. But now, I think coming to the issue that you're asking, I think some of the key challenges that we find generally in terms of treatment in our country is really, first of all, you know, the asymmetry between you know, what you may call the disease burden vis-a-vis, you know, the what you may call morbidity and mortality. Basically, how many people are sick and how many succumb, you know, to the cancer, you know, the cancer illness. And of course, I think our picture mirrors what probably we may see in many of the sub-Saharan African or many of the lower and middle income countries, that whereas the number of cases are, you know, are significant or sometimes even lower than, you know, in the developed world, we are seeing, you know, a lot of deaths, you know, from cancer. And then when you try and, you know, and up and try and interrogate, why is there such a disconnect between cases and deaths you know, in a situation of low and middle income countries vis-a-vis, you know, other settings. And a number of, you know, things come out, mainly from the patient perspective and also from a bigger system perspective. Now, from a patient perspective, of course, the key things there will be access to treatment, mainly financial access, and to a large extent, geographical access. Because, for example, like where I sit, something as something that is as essential as, you know, the radiotherapy treatment is only available in the capital city. So a patient diagnosed with cancer who maybe like 500 kilometers from the capital city will probably never get a chance to access such an essential mode of treatment as radiotherapy. So and that speaks to both, you know, of course the other issue is the issue of the financial access. As I think we all know that, many families in lower and middle income countries, you know, our poverty levels are fairly significant. So that means the disposable income accessible to, you know, to our individuals to be able to access treatment. I mean, they are bigger priorities, if you may. You know, they have to look for food, they have to, you know, to take their children to school. So sometimes, you know, they will sacrifice their well-being, you know, for the other basic things, you know, in their lives. So really, if we are to be successful, you know, in helping our patients to go through a successful journey, then a key issue that we must really address is access to care. I don't want to say treatment, because when you cancer is very unique in terms of it's a whole range of, you know, a whole range of services that a person would require, you know, from diagnosis. So there are systemic issues, there are systematic issues there that we need to address, because we need to make a diagnosis. And the environment must be strengthened to make sure that the diagnosis is there in terms of infrastructure, in terms of human resource, to make sure that we're actually able to link this person, you know, to treatment. So, from where we sit, those are some of the. I mean, as we talk about partnerships and as we talk about initiatives that make a difference, I think a key issue that we have been trying to see how best we can move forward is to see how such initiatives are able to, you know, to be broad based, to look at, you know, all the enabling factors that, you know, that would enable a patient, you know, to be able to, you know, to access treatment. And of course, the other thing that is really important on our side is that we. Coordinating efforts and, you know, synergies in what we do, because we realize that we welcome a lot of partnerships. I mean, from our country, we have seen a lot of interest and a lot of goodwill in terms of people willing to support. You know, everyone. You know, I think the thing about cancer is that it's an emotive, you know, issue. It's something that affects, you know, the society. So there is quite a lot of interest, you know, for people, you know, just trying to figure out how best can they contribute, you know, to addressing the burden. So I think one of the other issues that we really need to address is how then best we coordinate, you know, all these initiatives, all these efforts, you know, because sometimes you may find that there's much more that can be, you know, gained if we put up, you know, our resources together. So, for example, I have in mind, a partnership that we have been pursuing, you know, to sort of like address how best our patients can access breast cancer treatment. So, and you know, for you to be able to provide effective, you know, treatment for breast cancer, you know, there are certain tests, there are certain diagnostic issues that are involved, and you know, we were actually trying to, you know, to talk to two or three partners who have a similar idea, who have a similar thinking in terms of improving, you know, access to breast cancer treatment. So the challenge is, how then can they synergize, you know, their efforts, you know, to make sure that it's the same patient anyway who will benefit from, you know, from these initiatives. So really, the whole issue of coordination, making sure that I don't know, probably we need to think at what level can we achieve this coordination to make sure that whatever efforts, you know, we put in, you know, actually yield much more than us working, you know, individually. So probably from my perspective, those are some of the issues that that I would speak about that we see as very critical in terms of, you know, enhancing the patient journey and, you know, eventually yielding to, you know, more effective, more efficient access to treatment for our patients. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thanks, Dr. Krogwood. And, you know, you've raised, you introduced an important theme, that of the patient journey from, you know, first diagnosis of a cancer condition to effective treatment and ultimately, we hope, to long-term survival. And so, you know, and you very nicely showed the way in which, from the perspective of the National Cancer Institute, you're trying to coordinate a variety of perspectives and resources to ensure that that patient journey is as successful as possible. And I think another important point, in addition to the coordination that you mentioned, and we'll be talking more about that, is the fact that we should have our focus on better outcomes, as you put it, you know, that all of this yields a better outcome. You know, after all, that's the point of all the work that everybody on the patient journey is trying to accomplish. So our last speaker, but certainly not the least, is Dr. Sasan Almadi. And Sasan, I wanted to just ask you, in light of what the others have said, you know, one of the things we talked about a little bit in preparing this panel was we adapted a phrase that comes from another context, a political context, in which Hillary Clinton once wrote a book called It Takes a Village about child health and child care. And I think that, you know, in a sense, we've been talking around this, that the patient journey really takes a village to accomplish. And that village includes community organizations, patient advocacy groups, caregivers, and of course the doctors and nurses who provide the care in institutions like the National Cancer Institute. So from your perspective at Friends of Cancer Patients, talk a little bit about that village and the way that you help to provide the coordination that's needed for a successful patient journey.
Thank you, Jeff. I think sitting here and listening to my colleagues earlier and speaking about their experience is quite interesting. I would like to quote my late president, actually, who we just lost 10 days back, God rest her soul. And what she used to say is, there's not going to be enough money to cover a cancer patient treatment. No matter how much money you fund for, no matter how much resources you try to gather, there's always not going to be enough. And this is, I think, the idea where we need to find an established partnership to make sure that the resources that we have get utilized in the best way possible. It's true. You need more than a village, actually, when it comes to a cancer patient. And I think what we have done in Friends of Cancer Patient and in our very unique experience, in a way, is that we work both we are very much patient-focused and we are very much community-focused. So patient-focused, we provide access for patients. And we take that journey, patient journey, if I can use Alfred Ward's patient journey with the patient from the moment they get diagnosed till the moment they, you know, get treated and get hopefully get cured from the cancer. And we take the journey not with the cancer patient only, but we take it with the cancer patient family, because that's very important. Lots of people think, in our experience, we actually see the cancer patient family has more need than the patient. Patient need will be straightforward. They'll need the medication, they'll need the care. But sometimes we tend to forget the family along the way, which is actually most important, because those are the people who will provide the support for the patient outside the hospital setting. And sometimes they're more lost than the patient when it comes to, I need access to information, I want to know what can I do for my beloved one, how can I take care of them, especially if that's a child you're talking about, even an adult, actually. And when I say community-focused, I mean the organization do provide access to prevention and early diagnosis, and I think that is very important, because we keep on focusing on treatment, when if you look at, and we go back to policymakers, and I think we have two important distinguished policymakers on the panel, when we talk about policymaking, they're always thinking about cost-effectiveness. How is it cost effective? How is it cost effective? And let's balance, saving life and good outcome with cost effectiveness. And I think the best way to do that is invest more in the prevention side of cancer. So what we try to do with Friends of Cancer Patients is provide free access to screening program. And I think our flagship campaign is about breast cancer, where we provide more of a 360-degree kind of solution. We provide the awareness. We provide the clinical examination for free. We provide the screening mammogram for free. We provide the information and training. And also we provide the capacity building for the healthcare providers, because that is also very important. It doesn't make sense that you educate the community and you empower them with enough information and knowledge for a woman to take care of herself, but when she tries to go to her GP and say, well, I've just heard about this, I need to do this, I need to go have a mammogram at the age of 40, and the GP goes like, oh, I don't know, I'm not sure about that. So we have to strike that balance between educating the community as well, and also capacity building for the healthcare professional, which I think we are very much at the early stages right now. We have been adapting a model as well, where we provide, so right now we spoke about access of financial access for the patient, information access for the patient, and also screening access for the community. I think the most important access as well is that we're trying to do and we're trying to introduce right now on our simple organizational level is the navigation of the patient. Although United Arab Emirates is considered smaller as a country when it comes to geographically speaking, but we have a huge issue when it comes to the patient. Patient can be diagnosed in one city, but the treatment will be in another city. So the geographical access is definitely an issue, but it's not that. It's where the patient gets lost between the paperwork in a way. Where can I go? My doctor just told me I have cancer. What does that mean? I need to go to a certain hospital, which is 200 kilometers, 300 kilometers far away from where I live. So where should I go? How should I do it? All these kind of things, not beyond the geographical access and the information access, but also having somebody in that hospital who I can refer the patient to. And usually we don't work with doctors. I'm a doctor, I shouldn't be saying that, but we work with social workers who actually look at the patient as a human, where we actually still call them patients. We still call them patient at the end of the day. Patient did this, you are a patient, go do that. But in our organization, we call them beneficiaries, and we tend to actually work with social workers in those known hospitals in United Arab Emirates, where we look after them from all the social aspect and the medical aspect as well. So yes, actually, patient journey is important for us. One more thing, just to add before I go back to Jeff, is that yesterday I met a very wise woman in the Congress, and I think this is the beauty of Congresses like this, is that you meet the people that you never imagine meeting. And she said, I wish, her mission was to make sure that policymakers get to see dying cancer patients. And she said, only when they see them and they see how important it is to invest in proper healthcare and access and proper, they need to redefine what cost effective means when they do the policymaking. It's not about money, it's about saving that life. And she said, that was my mission. My mission is to put the policymaker in the same room with a dying cancer patient and let them experience that. I think that was very powerful. I still carry it in my mind, and I wanted to share it with you guys. And I think out of all this conference and meeting all the amazing people, she struck a chord in me. Thank you.
Thanks, Hassan. Your presentation reminds me about a famous analysis by Susan Zontag called Illness as Metaphor. And, in that, she, and this relates to this last anecdote you mentioned about how it would be good for policymakers to actually experience what it's like for somebody to be dying from cancer. What she said was that each of us has two passports. And we have a passport to the land of the healthy and to the land of the sick. And, at some point in our life, we're going to exchange one passport for the other. Yeah. And I just thought it was a very powerful metaphor for how, you know, each of us will either, you know, heaven forbid, will either get cancer, or some of the people in this room have already had cancer. I'm sure each of us has experience of relatives and friends who have had experiences with cancer. And so, you know, we're closer to that exchange between the passport for the land of the healthy and the yeah. land of the ill than we realize. You know, some of us live in one land all the time, and others are lucky enough, and really it is just a question of luck, given the incidence and prevalence of cancers around the world. Some of us are lucky enough to live in the other land. But, you know, it's at sessions like this and at conferences like this where we really can reflect on what's required to ensure that people can successfully complete the journey from one land to the other and really be able to live lives as fully as possible if they are affected by cancer. So let's now just open the discussion a little bit. One of the themes that emerged from each of your presentations is this question of the patient journey and how to navigate along the patient journey. And one of the points I wanted to just focus on from initially from Sossin's presentation was the importance of prevention and early diagnosis. You know, we know from some of the major studies that have been done about cancer prevention that, you know, there are things that that governments and other actors can do. You know, tobacco control is probably the single most important thing to do to prevent certain kinds of cancer, and immunization for hepatitis B and human papillomavirus will also be important in preventing cervical cancer and liver cancer. So those are some of the, you know, prevention interventions that are important. There are certainly others. But with prevention and early diagnosis, let me make a statement or ask a question that might be somewhat provocative. You know, often this is seen from the point of view of the medical community and what doctors and nurses should be doing to instruct patients and their families about prevention and early diagnosis. But another way of looking at this, and we've heard some examples of this from Vijay and Sossin, is that you can operate from the assumption that the individual cancer patient is more expert in that condition than any doctor or nurse. And the families of cancer patients also understand a lot about the impact of this condition on people. So what I'd like to ask you to do is just reflect on the role that patients and their families and patient advocates can play in working together with the medical and nursing communities to ensure more effective prevention and early diagnosis programs, of encouraging people to seek diagnosis. You know, what are the relative roles as you see them? And, you know, let me just throw that open to everybody, since you probably all have opinions on that. Who'd like to start?
You know, I'd like to talk, say something about when we're all speaking of the patient journey and how it's part of that journey. It's that one place, that one defining moment when the patient also realizes that he or she can use his experience to become the voice of positivity. Like, we're all on this journey, all of us, not just the patient, you know, beginning of life to end of life. And end of life is death, but are we really worried or concerned, or does it frighten us in any way? It really doesn't, because we're in this journey with our family, our neighbors, our colleagues, our best friends, and we're having a wonderful time. We are cherishing and we are nurturing this life that we've been blessed with. But at some point in time in that journey, some of us have to get off at a totally unexpected, unwanted, unexplained station that's called, in this room, we're all talking about cancer today, that station called cancer. And then you don't want to. You want to go on, you know, with the happiness and the contentment and whatever we are, you know, we want to achieve in our life with our colleagues and friends and family. But no, you have to get off at that station. You have cancer. So there's isolation, there's fear, there's desperate, you're just wondering, what are you going to do here now? When you wanted to be on that track and you're on another track. And after a while, you find somebody else is getting down at that station. And then yet another person, and then yet another person. And then that's when you realize that, you know what, I have to make a new community here. I have to find a path for myself, and I have these people here with me. And then you realize if you just calm yourself and still yourself, you're really not alone at that particular point. There is maybe a patient support group. There are maybe some physicians who are already prepared themselves. There are some other kind of partners who are there. And our patients actually find a new meaning in life. And they stop seeing themselves as patients, but they start seeing themselves as somebody who has the power to make a change. And like you said, yes, maybe go up, go to the government, go to the policymakers, make a difference and empower yourself. And then what happens to that group? I think that group is what you could call a support group. And I love it when you say your group is called Friends of Cancer Patients. Yes. The support group that we've set up is called Friends of Max. And I think that's I just love hearing that. So this is the support group that decides that they're not alone. They may not be able to get back onto that track where everybody else is on, but they also are. They want to go to their own end of life too, but they will choose another parallel track. They will choose a new normal. They will find their new normal, and that's what today's patients are doing. And support from the physicians, treating physicians look at patients in a different manner now. They look at patients also as partners. They have a say in their treatment protocol, in how they want their treatment, where they have to go with it. And I guess the one component that's missing is good support from the respective governments. That is where I think we lack in a lot of countries. The government is unable to give the kind of support that a patient and the patient's family really needs.
Okay, who'd like to comment next? Go ahead.
I just have a small comment, if I can add. I do agree, yes, absolutely, what you have said, Gigi. The other thing is, I think we need to give the family and the patient more platform, more freedom to speak. I think we can learn a lot from them. We usually, sometimes, during the course of me working in front of cancer patient, I go on presuming that this is what they want, and I go like, "Yeah, this is what I'm going to provide to you as an organization," but I still get surprised by the amount of knowledge and my ignorance at the same time. So I think patients and the family, we can learn a lot from them. And I do agree with you that they do, in a way, find their path into their new normality of a way. I've seen a lot of patients, especially breast cancer patients, who went, got the disease, and they are treated and they are cured. And now they are actually more empowered as a woman, as a human being. And they are now motivational speakers. And they speak about the experience as if this is the best thing that ever happened to them in their life. And I think it's all about the attitude. I agree that there is lots of good support groups out there that has been lobbying with the government to change policies and influence new based on their experience, not based of what we think they need in their patient journey. I think just giving them the platform and just listening to what they have to say is very powerful. I think a patient voice is very powerful, and the family as well.
Well, so Alfred and excuse me, and Dr. Cabaccio, I wanted to ask you just to respond to this question. How does in the National Cancer Institute and in government policymaking, how do you listen to the voices of patients and their families?
Well, I think I speak from our own experience. We actually we acknowledge greatly the role of patients and the role of caregivers in terms of that they have a role, they have a contribution to make in their own care and treatment. And we find that there's a lot of when you visit many of our treatment facilities, there's a very deliberate effort from the caregiver's perspective, first of all, to encourage the patients first and foremost, to form this kind of support groups, because in their own way they are very therapeutic. It's a forum for them to speak about their experiences, to encourage one another for treatment and so forth. But from my experience, I think one of the greatest challenge I think that we have I look at it, one of the first ways of making this happen is actually empowering the patients with information. And that's where sometimes I find a challenge, especially from our setting, because I don't know if it's probably because of the nature of our training. I mean, you'd find that the medical training has not really dwelt too much on the psychosocial, aspects of, how do you pass on bad news? How do you actually talk to a patient? Giving both the positive side and the negative sides of the treatment. So I think that's one thing that we are seeing, that our caregivers just have a problem in terms of how they pass information to their clients, and not so much because probably the patient will take it badly. Sometimes I think it's just the fear is actually within the caregiver rather than even the patient. So that's something that we're trying to see how we can address, especially through we are doing a lot of, as part of our palliative care trainings, patient communication is a key component in that. But more, I think specifically, we need to address it from the very beginnings. When you're in our undergraduate programs, in our basic training programs, we are really trying to to integrate issues of communication too, because I think we have rightly been accused of sometimes we don't empower our patients adequately, because when we again flip the coin and look at probably the experiences of other chronic illnesses like HIV, we have seen the benefit of an empowered, patient. They are able to come out, and give hope and, encourage patients to be adherent to the treatment and so forth. So I think we're trying to, use that kind of experience to try and foster, more patient empowerment through, empowering our care providers first, because they really have a big role to play by engaging both first of all the patients and also their caregivers, or either the patients or relatives, to try and understand what the patient is going through, because that then again would help them influence others positively. So I think for me, empowering the caregiver to be able to in turn empower the patient is very critical.
No, that's an important point. Mm-hmm. Joseph.
Okay, just briefly, and I agree with most of these points. And when Susan talked about policymakers requiring an opportunity in their lives where they see the dying patient, I've had the, I don't know whether to call it interesting experience. My own mother is dying of cancer of the lung. And every morning I wake up and I'm like, here I am, a policymaker. And in as much as I'm a doctor, I try to imagine, what about somebody else who is not a doctor? I can understand what's going on. I know the A and the Z. But there's somebody else who is going through a difficult patch. And I've seen my own mother, in the journey that Viji was talking about, dying before she's dead. I see a strong woman that I have known for a long time, collapsing, losing hope, and, and there's very little that I can do with all my knowledge. So I know the value for policymakers to investing in empowering patients. And I know one of the things we are trying to do, and Alfred has alluded to it, is the use of non-oncology staff to give care. If you look at Sub-Saharan Africa, 60, 70, even up to 80% of the care is in the hands of nurses. These are very important cadre, and most of them, again, are women who also have their own issues and are carers anyway in another setting. And when I looked at my own mother, most of the support that she has had is probably not even from her oncologists, who are many and friends of mine. It's from that nurse who comes to push the drugs and, talks to her. So I have come to find out that a big chunk of what this lady needs is really not about the chemo. It's the human touch. Absolutely. To the chemo. It's how it's presented. It's not what is presented. So, and I know that component to policymakers is lost. We just think, okay, there is now a radiotherapy machine in Nairobi Hospital. Oh, now there is access to chemo. We've done our thing. And I think that's just a small little part of it. There's the human part of it, which I think sometimes does not even cost money. It's a policy change, it's a perspective change, it's an attitude change, which, yeah, of course, costs money to spread that around, but it's not as expensive as the primary infrastructure for cancer. Having said that, we now, and I must speak of it as an individual, look at it differently. We're trying to see how do we make the journey of the patient more bearable. I can tell you when a villager from, let's say, 500 kilometers from Nairobi is referred to the National Hospital, oh my, their problems begin there. They don't have a relative in the city. They don't know anybody. Some of them actually hold back and they're like, you know, you're in denial. You just bury your head in the sun and hope that this thing goes away. And finally, it's too big for you to ignore. And you also have sanctions from neighbors. If it's a fungating wound, how can you be walking around? So they push you to go to the very Nairobi. And when you arrive there, where do you begin? So the patient navigation that you're talking about is a small little thing that can change a lot. So we are working with civil society that are trying to do a simple thing, for example, like creating a hostel for people when they arrive in Nairobi. You're waiting for your care tomorrow. Where do you sleep in the night? Some of them sleep in the benches in the hospital, which is sometimes deplorable. So these are small little things that make access a whole package. So for sure, policymakers are responding in a very different way, but more so to move towards the human touch of the treatment. Thanks.
I would like to also add something here when you said it's so much more than the attending costs, the unseen costs, and to access a drug that is given to the patient at no cost, like you said, not donated, not free, but no cost to the patient. There are so many unseen costs that the patient has to actually find resources for to even come and avail of that benefit.
Yeah, no, I think that those. No, I wanted to just underscore how important the point Joseph just made about the human touch in cancer care is critical. And, you know, this is an important part of really understanding the patient journey, to have help with those unseen costs. And really, from the patient's point of view, if you're somebody who's just been diagnosed, or you're a family member who is working, you know, helping a relative who's just been diagnosed, you know, I've had that experience as well. You know, my own father died of liver cancer. And there are just so many questions you have that you don't even know where to turn for the answers. And, you know, it can really, you end up expending a lot of energy and worry and trying to gain that understanding. And then also, once you find somebody who can give you the answers, there's really a sense of relief and hope that you may make it through after all. And that's, you know, you've heard examples now from both Sasan and Vijay on how their organizations help patients and their families do that. And I think it was, you know, also from Joseph and Alfred, you've heard from their perspective how they try to provide that kind of help for the patient journey and also empower patients and their caregivers to help policymakers make the right choices. I wanted to just switch gears for the last few minutes of this general discussion before we open the floor. To ask a different level of question. At the outset, I said you were going to hear some practical issues around creating partnerships to improve cancer care and control. So that's the question I'd like to pose now about partnerships. How do you find the right partners? How do you create the partnerships that are going to help patients and their families? What are the issues that have to be addressed in organizing, in managing those partnerships and sustaining them? So that's those are some big questions, but let's just spend a few minutes on those issues, and then we'll turn to the audience. So who would like to start on this, the practical issues around partnerships?
I would like to start, if that's okay. Possible. I think before we start, about talking about partnership and identifying partnership and approaching partnership, I think we need to be clear about what is my objective with that partnership. What do I want to gain? What do I want to gain out of that partnership? Objective is very important. And also, I need to identify that partnership is with sector. Is it a governmental sector? Is it a private sector? Or it's an NGO or a civil society like myself? Because each partner, according to their sector, I have to speak to them with their language for me to reach them. Because if I start speaking with my civil society language, if I want to speak to a private sector, they will not care about me. They want to care about their investment. They want to care about their bottom line. They want to care about how that partnership will make them look good. So I really need to, you know, I find it takes a lot of experience. I mean, we're talking about how to tap into their CSR programs, how to tap into their once historically called philanthropy kind of sector in their organization. I think that is very important. Objective, what type of sector you are targeting, why am I targeting that those partners? Most of the civil society thinks that the healthcare sector is the ideal partner. Out of our experience, we found the actually the private banking sector was a great partner for us when we did our community outreach breast cancer, what we call the Pink Caravan campaign in the United Arab Emirates. Banking sector were very intrigued. They thought that helping us reach, so far we have reached 41,000 women and men in screening breast cancer. Yes, we screen men as well. And they found that as a great investment for them. And for them, they took all the data, of course, respecting patient privacy and community. We just gave them data. We fed back on the data that we have generated out of the 6 years screening that we have done. And they took it and they developed their own CSR program internally and externally. They found that that was a great platform for them to increase their market exposure as the friendly bank who helps screen 41,000 person in the United Arab Emirates and save 31 lives, which actually the number of cancer cases, breast cancer cases that we have discovered, including a man again. So again, it's all about us as a civil society, as an organization, being organized enough to approach those partnership. When I started with Friends of Cancer Patient in 2003, I refused to work with pharma companies for 5 years. Not because I didn't want to work with them, because I thought I wasn't ready for them. It's as simple as this. I wasn't ready to partner with a pharma company. I had to be ready with my outcomes. I had to be strong enough as an organization to go and sit and negotiate with the pharma company head to head. Not somebody who's begging to have a helping hand or I need this for this. No, I need to sit and I say, this is what I want because that's my objective. So I need, first of all, we need to be very clear about our goals and how we are approaching the partner.
I like that, that we have to be ready to,
you have to be
approach
ready.
Our partners.
If I look and see
who are our partners, the various patient groups are our partners. We have a network of amazing, patient advocates who form these groups, and we give them a platform. We foster their growth and their establishment. Healthcare professionals are our partners. They're very, very important to us. And of course, pharma companies are our partners. Where would we be if we did not have the support of pharma companies? And I think it's very important to show to each of your partners that you, in turn, also have something to give to them. What is partnership? Partnership is trust and faith. That's so cool. Whoever is your partner, you have to go with these two, with trust and faith. And believe me, you cannot go wrong at that level. I know I took away the mic from you.
No, it's all right. Maybe just to reflect on how partnerships look from the perspective of government. Every day in my office, if I may just give an example, I see close to 5 different groups. There is pharmaceutical and not only one, like 3-4 of them who come because they want us to partner on something on NCDs, be it diabetes, cancer, tomorrow is hypertension, many things. The playing field of partnerships currently now is in the NCD field because that's where globally everybody is moving. And so, one, I have pharmaceuticals, two, I have NGOs, I have civil society, I have faith-based organization, I have everybody who is coming to say, okay, we do a small thing on something, we want to partner with government. Now, the biggest conflict or the biggest difficulty for us is, as government, our doors are open. We are public servants. We have to give hearing to everybody. And in that giving hearing to everybody, of course, we have to have a very critical framework of engagement, because therein comes conflicts, therein comes issues of compliance, therein comes a lot of issues that sometimes divert us from what we are working towards, for example, a strategy or a policy of government. Let me just say that and I agree with Sosan, I think you're the one who said for a long time you've not worked with pharma, yeah, until maybe you understood things. Governments for a long time have worked with pharma in the partnerships of, you have the money, give us the money, we throw it at a problem, and that's it. But we have realized that there can be a win-win. We have our objectives. Pharma, at the end of the day, despite them having an economic bottom line, they definitely have a social bottom line, I assume, most of them. Even beyond the corporate social responsibility, they also are human beings, of course. And there's a very thin line between understanding them and misunderstanding big pharma, as we call them. And I think when we come together, we genuinely and put all our cards on the table, really, do they put all of them on the table? But I think there is a way in which we can strike a win-win solution. So our government has been changing our way of doing partnerships to trying and understand that you're here with objectives and I have my objectives. And we have a strategy. It's a small river that joins the big river here. So when pharma comes with the partnerships, we try and tell them, look at our strategy, our cancer strategic plan. Where can you plug in? Where can you do your thing that it adds up to the strategy and the general direction we are moving? Because in the past, it would divert us to this direction, somebody else. As I've told you, I deal with like so many guys. So if I have to look in all those directions, you lose focus and it wastes a lot of time. Now, the second thing is, for example, currently at the WHO, we have been working, and it was passed through during the World Health Assembly last year, the Framework Convention, the Framework Engagement with Non-State Actors, because government engaging with non-state actors is a big thing. You have to protect the image of government, you have to protect even the people you are working with. And so I know that there's a way in which we can work without stepping on each other's toes. Now, let me just say that most of the partnerships we are having are treatment-based and product-based. You know, you come in because we have a product here, we want to see how it can be accessed. It's all right. I mean, that's a place to start. But every time people come to us, we try and tell them, can we try and broaden it beyond just the molecule? Because even this molecule will not be given without people being educated. This molecule won't be given without empowering the patient. This molecule won't be given without investing upstream towards prevention and awareness and even downstream towards palliative care. So we try and broaden it to mirror our strategic plan. And then also try and make it look like it's bankable also to invest in upstream interventions that don't look bankable from an economic point of view. And then finally, we also look at the barriers that affect partnerships. And maybe I should just mention a few. How do we align our objectives? Sometimes the objectives are way conflicting. It's very difficult to align government objectives sometimes with product-based project. So it requires a lot of engagement and honesty and seeing what is our end point and how do we sustain this. And then the other one is, for example, with civil society. Civil society's primary job is to keep the government's feet in the fire. You know, we tend to run away. So your job is to keep us on our promises and to... So how do we partner with this? I'll give an example of the NCD Alliance. Great guys we work with in Kenya. And every time I attend their meetings, I have to give the disclaimer that I'm here not as government, but as an individual, because otherwise we will lose the focus. It's difficult for you to hear my contribution if you're here to put me in check. And it's very difficult sometimes to draw that line. And then finally, there are small little things that mean a lot, but sometimes are lost in some of these partnerships. So we keep reviewing the partnerships over and over as we go along. It's not a thing that is cast on stone. We usually ask the partners to be very flexible because governments change, policies change midway. Today, a political wind might come that totally changes the way we had agreed. So we ask a lot of flexibility, and that's the only way probably that some of these partnerships can be sustained.
Well, thank you. Those are important points to add. Do you want to comment on this as well, Alfred?
Well, I think we seem to have quite a bit of shared thoughts, so I'll probably just, in a way of summarizing, some of this could have been mentioned. But really, I think from a government perspective or from a healthcare perspective, I think for partnerships for us, I think, one, we want them to align with our priorities. I think it's, in terms of ownership, in terms of sustainability, they really must be aligned with the existing priorities of either at the policy level or at the healthcare provider level. And then, of course, I think this has been mentioned about, what I may call, probably for lack of a better word, full disclosure. Sometimes I think information is not, information is not, there's no sense of shared information among, you know, the partners involved. So that is critical, because if this, if you are holding back, there are some things that, you know, that may, that that may be lacking from my side, that may help me in terms of, in terms of contributing more or making decisions about the partnership. So I think, you know, sharing, you know, having a shared vision that helps us know to basically, you know, exchange freely the information regarding what you are doing. And finally, I think the issue of building capacity. You know, a partnership should ensure that each of the partners at the time of, you know, for the duration that in which we are in partnership, and even after, you know, the partnership, you know, it comes to an end, it should leave us, it should leave both parties stronger. So I think partnerships should look at how do we strengthen, you know, the capacity of each of the partners involved to make sure that, I mean, you know, resources come and go, but for the time that in which we are in engagement, then there should, it should contribute, you know, to, you know, a longer term, you know, a longer term results. So the issue of building capacity, for, you know, local capacity is really important for a successful partnership.
Oh, Jeff, you. I want to say just something before we stop. I want to just say this, a very perfect partnership that we've had with Novartis for 15 years now, an exemplary access program. I mean, I'm wondering at the foresight, you know, that was put to use at that point in time by involving a nonprofit to administer a drug donation program, a direct-to-patient program, and that gave birth to not just a new system, you know, that was put into place very intuitively, but today could be such a perfect example for so many other partnerships like this in access to treatment that they could use. And it gave birth to the concept of a patient support group. And when I look at the things that we have done within the framework of this particular donation program, I think it's just, it's mind-boggling. Mm. It was an unprecedented move, an unprecedented program, you know, putting a nonprofit in charge of distributing, identifying and working and counseling with the patient. It's just something that's, I think unprecedented is the only word that I can look for the kind of partnership. I think that's worthy of emulating.
Yeah, no, and it's a good example of what Alfred was just talking about, building capacity that makes all parts of the system stronger and is actually able to deliver more on behalf of patients and their families. Well, now is the time for questions and comments from the audience. So please just, in order for as many as possible to comment, keep your intervention short, and please start by identifying yourself.
Okay. Good morning, and thank you for the excellent panel. I'm Sharmani Chakraborty from Merck. And I really would like to direct a comment and a question to the Kenyan colleagues here. Firstly, I fully endorse what you said about the stewardship role of the government vis-a-vis scaling up private sector interventions. If you remember, 10, 15 years ago, we talked about sector-wide approaches. As we go forward involving the private sector, we have to think of swaps that involve the private sector. And then a question is, the topic of financing always comes up for NCDs. And there are some good examples globally. For example, the Philippines government that did a sin tax reform to cover health insurance for the poor. What are your thoughts on potential possibilities in Kenya in that area? Thank you very much.
Okay, so we'll give Alfred and Joseph a moment to think about that and ask, let's take a couple of more comments. Go ahead.
Okay, Aaron Schwartz from the Max Foundation, and I can feel that there's a lot of collective wisdom in the room. I appreciate it. As I sit in this Congress and listen to all the different speakers, I think there's the possibility that there's kind of an underlying assumption that the people from, we're supposed to learn from the high-income countries how they can help in low-income and middle-income countries. And I know there's this concept of reverse innovation. And I guess I just would ask, what do you feel that the high-income countries can learn from lower and middle-income countries? I mean, there's so much wisdom in the efficiencies and many things I'm sure you can think of. So I hope that you could share some examples of what the message would be to high-income countries and learning.
Good question. Let's take one more. Go ahead.
Hi, Ali Bukowski from Mass General Hospital in Boston. I would just like to hear a little bit more about your conversations or bargaining with pharmaceutical companies, because a lot of the conversation has revolved around your responsibility to provide access to medications for patients, but maybe not the step before, which is pharma's responsibility to provide access to medications for you to provide to the patients. And I think that that our colleagues from Kenya did mention that, you know, it's your goals are at odds when you're a government or a nonprofit speaking with a for-profit who does have an economic bottom line. Those are directly at odds, and I was just wondering, you know, how you see, you know, maybe bargaining for those small donations of medicines for X number of patients or X number of years, and if that undermines the bargaining power of the country as a whole to provide medicines for their entire system, or because one of the problems is that because of fragmentation and less in bargaining power in LMICs, they actually pay more per unit of medicine or per patient than high-income countries. And I think that that's a little scary. And so I just would like to hear more about how you do speak with pharmaceutical companies about that and how you do achieve your objectives to provide for very disadvantaged patients.
Okay, well, those are some good questions. We've got swaps and financing, health insurance options, reverse innovation, or what does the developed world have to learn from lower and middle income countries? And finally, you know, what are some of the practical issues around negotiating solutions with pharmaceutical companies, and how does one keep a wide range of interests in mind when doing that? So who would like to start?
I could take the last question first.
Yeah? Sure.
Because both parties, whether it's the nonprofit or if it's the pharma company, we have the interest of the patient at heart, first and foremost. And when you have the interest of the patient at heart, you really don't go to a table and bargain. You ask. And if you ask with enough data, with enough courage, and with enough material to let them know that this is what is required and this is the life of a patient, it matters. So then you get what you want. You don't bargain. Not on a patient's life.
I agree, actually. I think we need to go out of that bargaining kind of mind frame and think about sustainable solutions. Because at the end of the day, if we can find a model that can work for X disease or X cancer, type of cancer, then maybe we can generalize it for the other type. And I do agree with Iji that we have a very successful model as well in the United Arab Emirates, where we have been working with Novartis for the past 2 years on providing a medication for CML patients. And because the model is so successful, now we're looking into other pharma companies to start implementing and start buy-in into that model. So I think we really need to go into that mind frame of sustainability, because only when we think like that, and again, I would quote Joseph, it has to be a win-win for both. And I think the bigger winner here is the patient at the end of the day. And this is the end objective of what we're trying to do right now. I'll go back to how we learn from what can, and I think my African colleagues from Africa can elaborate more. Somebody spoke about the HIV experience. I'm not sure if it's Alfred or Joseph. I believe we can learn a lot from the HIV model. It doesn't matter if it's an infectious versus an uncommunicable or a cancer. I think the model itself, how they mobilize the resources in Africa, how they made it possible that all those thousands of patients get on treatment that is very, at that time, was experimental, was very expensive, and yet lots of people in Africa got, what was the model? There is a recipe there that we learn from. And I think there is a lot to be learned if we take that model, just HIV. I'm not the person to speak about it. I'm sure my colleagues will be more expert in that. I love to learn that. I love to learn how they mobilize. Of course, we're speaking about infectious diseases versus non-infectious. The urgency may be a little bit higher, but why not have the same urgency with the non-communicable diseases? I mean, I believe there is lots to learn from them, if anything. I mean, how they use their resources. is how they squeeze that dollar to really make sure that they get the best out of it, how they mobilize the partnerships. I think there is a lot to be learned. Yes.
In the same way, in India, we have the polio eradication campaign. Yeah. Polio is something that's been totally wiped out now, and that campaign is something that every country and whichever part of the world can learn from, and that's really something incredible.
Good. And go ahead, Joseph.
All right. Maybe I must admit some of the questions are quite difficult, but let me start by maybe addressing the third one from Boston. Sorry, I didn't get the name, but I got you from Boston. You're right that some of the objectives of government and the objectives of the pharma are directly at odds, and usually that is a starting point. And usually we ask the question, how do we exit on the other end with a win-win solution? So maybe not use the name negotiations here, because when you look, and sorry, I might sound theoretical here, but when you look at the two ethos that the two teams are using, the pharma, of course, looks at unitarian, if I may say, ethos, where, oh, we have 10 patients here who might need a treatment for a very rare cancer here, and we have the drug, and it will cost the country $2 million or something. Then me as government, I have 2 million guys here who have cancer who need me to stretch this dollar for the many. So both patients, yes, require the treatment. As government, of course, sometimes you take the high position of looking at how do you stretch the coin to serve more and probably more upstream. But of course, in terms of pharma, we are looking at downstream to sell the molecule. I agree with you that that's the starting point. But the question is, sometimes we focus mostly on the base of the pyramid. The people who are the working poor, who probably might not have enough money to buy the treatment, and we try and see how do we meet in the middle. It's a very difficult question. Depends on where you're standing. Every time you analyze with a tooth comb some of these contracts or something, you will always see like the government has been shortchanged from, you know, the plain truth of the matters. But when you put everything together, it actually starts making sense that community, when you now put the social part of it, the role of government is to provide for care, of course, at a cost-effective, way. But also when you look at it broadly from a political point of view, then it starts making sense. But I must say that sometimes it's difficult because, as Alfred said, sometimes we don't put all our cards on the table, and it takes time. And as I said, there's a lot of flexibility that is called. A new government comes and says, no, this is not right, and probably it's renegotiated. And I always say it's not free, even though the donations are not free, it's at no cost. Somebody is paying for it somewhere. Exactly. So I must say that it takes the honesty of the pharmaceutical government and the pharmaceutical company and the legitimacy of government realizing that this is their role. So I will probably not go beyond that. There was a question from the Max Foundation on how, what can the countries in the West or the people who are upper learn from the lower. I think there's a lot. Sometimes there's the notion that in the upper income countries, there's no one who is at lack. Oh yeah, there is a lot. There is a lot of inequalities within even that country. There are people who don't have access. So I think the issue of reaching everybody and not leaving anybody behind, and also the issue of achieving much with less. Sometimes I'm sure you wonder, how do we function? How do we use the little we have to reach everybody? So I think there's still some lessons. And as Susanna said, the lessons that we have learned from the HIV. But also there is the reverse lessons of a global society. I mean, if one of us is hurting, then all of us are hurting. You wouldn't enjoy your benefits while you know somewhere somebody else is hurting. So how do we distribute global good public goods so that everybody has access? Of course, as a government in the West, your legitimacy role is for these people. But it can be spread out without jeopardizing your constitutional right for those people. The final one is about the stewardship and the role of the private sector. It's a beautiful question. For us, we appreciate the role that the private sector plays in our country. And the current debate, if I may just tell you, the current debate that is there in cancer is the cancer infrastructure that is available in the private sector, Nairobi Hospital, the Aga Khan Hospital, if well utilized, is actually enough. The machines in Nairobi and Aga Khan University Hospital are silent in the night. while in the public hospital in Nairobi, in the Kenyatta University, Kenyatta Hospital, there are thousands of patients waiting for the same. So we say, how can we utilize your idle capacity as private sector, subsidize it, and we're always looking for this win-win. And the private sector becomes a very key partner to us. And we don't take it for granted that they are there to make a profit. Otherwise, they would not be able to exist. So we see, how do we meet halfway? You reduce your price, we subsidize a little, we use your idle capacity in the night. So there's a big, big role for the private sector. The only question we keep asking is, how can we entice the private sector to invest in things that don't look bankable? For example, prevention. Early detection, diagnosis. Most of the times when we say we partner with private sector, we are talking at the tail end, you know, treatment. But there's a lot with which we can partner upstream, and we can use subsidies to entice the private sector too, because ultimately they'll be helping us in our job. So it's a debate maybe we can have later, but you can rest assured that we as the government really appreciate the role of the private sector. Thank you.
Thanks. And
Alfred, you'll have more.
Yes, I think I'll probably just add a few insights. I just pick on where Joseph finished about, you know, partnering with the private sector. I think one of the ways that we're seeing results is through our social health insurance fund. Our hospital insurance fund actually enables our patients to access, you know, treatment in the private sector. That has had, already in the, probably in the past 3-6 months, has had huge, you know, implications in terms of reducing even the patient loads at our public, at our only public referral hospital. For example, the part of the oncology package includes, covering for radiotherapy treatment in the private sector. So we know with such, the package has only been there for about 3-4 months. So we see moving forward, when that is working efficiently, that would be a good, you know, public-private partnership that would actually even start addressing some of the challenges we have in terms of access. I think there was a question asked about possibilities for health financing in Kenya. I think at some point we have actually legislated against, we have some piece of legislation looking at having a tobacco fund. I think the challenge has actually been operationalizing the tobacco fund. And probably the other bigger challenge is in terms, probably call for a bit more advocacy to make sure that the fund does not just go to the bigger budget, or it should be structured in such a way that the tobacco control fund, for example, can directly, you know, be plowed back to interventions, you know, that are more specific to NCD. So I think that's probably now the moving forward, what we need to, you know, to look at. How do we actually make sure that the sin tax, as it is, actually, you know, hits onto what it its health implications. I think there has been also, what you're also seeing is that with the talk of reducing funding for HIV, for example, governments are trying to think through how best then do they start generating local resources for that. And I think there has been mention of, you know, like using, adding a small levy to, you know, airtime, you know, for, because that's, you know, looking at very commonly used, you know, commodities, and just attaching, you know, some small markup that can then, feedback to and be used to fund locally, you know, some of the health services. So those are some options that moving forward might be, you know, might be possibilities. I think the other bigger issue is the change in governance in our country. You know, right now we have the devolved system of governments that gives probably autonomy to the lower levels of government to even develop their own, you know, legislation. So we are seeing this state, or what we call counties in our country, developing laws that actually are targeting some of the risk factors. So, for example, you are seeing a county developing, you know, a tobacco control, you know, bill for the county. You know, those are opportunities for them to actually now, you know, put in place some of these, you know, some of these funding opportunities that directly touch on, NCD and, you know, for example, like cancer and many other things. So those are, you know, possibilities that we think, you know, would help in terms of putting more resources to, you know, to cancer prevention and control in the country. Probably the other thing that, in terms of the, what is to learn from our setting, I think we have seen the issue of community participation, especially when you look at broadly, you know, HIV prevention, maternal and child health. The, what we're talking about, you know, breaking the barriers, you know, in terms of awareness, in terms of you know, demand creation, community participation has been, you know, a working, it has been actually demonstrated to work, you know, in terms of spreading the message to the community, you know, to and making sure that people access the treatment. So that, for me, is one of the big things that we probably, you know, can, you know, talk about. And of course, the issue of task shifting that came with HIV, those are some of the things that probably we have seen, we have seen them work in other settings, and, you know, people can learn from us. That's how I would put it. But those are a few things that we can also, you know, talk about as working in our setting.
Terrific. Well, we've come to the point where inevitably we could spend hours more on this discussion, and actually in just the last few minutes we've opened some interesting new areas for further dialogue. Unfortunately, the constraints of this conference are that we have to draw things to a close right now. I wanted to just point to four conclusions that I think come from this morning's discussion. One is, first, the importance of understanding the patient journey. From initial diagnosis through to understanding what options there are for treatment, and then how patients and their families work together with providers to ensure that they can navigate the patient journey successfully as possible. The second point is the role of patients and communities as partners in care and treatment. That came out very strongly from all of the comments that our panelists made, whether from the point of view of those like Sasan and Viji, who work as patient advocates and work in the community, or Joseph and Alfred, who are looking at this from the perspective of government or from a major care institution, the National Cancer Institute in Kenya, that everybody spoke about the importance of understanding the role of patients as partners and the importance of the community in improving cancer care and control. The third has to do with partnerships. And we, you know, we promised you some practical perspectives on partnerships, and my colleagues on the panel didn't disappoint us. You know, they pointed out that fundamentally you have to start with common objectives, that transparency and communication lead to trust and faith in each other as partners. If you then align around those objectives and are adaptable as you move forward, you find that you can be very successful at improving the outcomes for cancer patients. And the fourth point has to do with sustainability. You know, Alfred made the point that another aspect of partnerships is to build capacity in the system to deal more effectively with cancer. We just at the end were talking about stewardship and how, for instance, the public sector can use private sector resources to provide care to more people in the public sector, and that it's possible to use incentives to encourage the private sector to do more on issues that they wouldn't necessarily have addressed otherwise. And we ended really with, you know, the theme of solidarity. As Joseph put it, you know, if one of us is suffering, all of us are suffering. And I think that that's really an important perspective. And also, as all the speakers said, we have to remember that we're talking about human issues. It's not that patients are different than the rest of us. We're all ultimately patients, and all of us will face these issues across our lifetime. So it's important to keep in mind holistic solutions that where we understand that there's a certain fundamental issue of solidarity in this that will help us find the right sustainable solutions in the long run. So I want to just end by saying we promised you a lively discussion. I think you'd have to agree that it was lively, provocative, and informative. And the last thing I have to do as your moderator is ask you to join me in thanking our panelists, you know, Sasan, Joseph, Viji, and Alfred for such a great session.